The Chamber is pleased to present today's economic development update with the City of Springfield. We've been doing these presentations, I think, for 5 or 6 years now, and every year I think this is the last year. We can't possibly have any more great news to celebrate. And then it dawns on me that the reason we have more development each year is because we have a mayor who gets it, who understands that every park project, every new facade, every business expansion, every new company is a step along a pathway that leads us to a bigger and brighter future. It's a new wave. Please welcome my friend, Mayor Dominic Sarno.
Thank you, Nance, and thank you for saying it just the way I wrote it. I appreciate that very, very much. Let's give Nancy Creed, the president of the Chamber of Commerce, a big round of applause. It's been a great partnership. We work very closely with our chamber on a good four-letter word, jobs, J-O-B-S. I want to thank John DeLiva and Paul Lambert for always opening up the one and only Basketball Hall of Fame in the world. And doesn't it look fantastic? And they're not even done yet. Speaking of basketball, out of the Republican yesterday, it's March Madness. Gonna do your brackets, right? Well, my chief development officer, Kevin Kennedy, has been a great tactician when it comes to doing economic development. And we keep filling out these brackets as we continue to move towards another championship. Now, I know you look back, we had the challenges, not only urban challenges that we continue to face and conquer, whether with our financial situation, the highest bond ratings in the city's history, our schools under Superintendent Dan Warwick moving forward, our public safety. Thank you. Schools are very, very important in economic development. Our public safety and reducing overall crime 45% in the last 5 years. And $3.7 billion in economic development has occurred. But just since last year, when we did our last presentation, over $400 million is occurring, and some other surprises Kevin will be announcing very shortly, to get us to over $4.1 billion of investment here in the city of Springfield. Not only in mega projects, but in each and every one of our neighborhoods, whether it's parks and schools and libraries and housing, infrastructure. I know my DPW director, Chris Signoli, is here, our finances with TJ Plant. So we're hitting on all cylinders, and I think that's extremely important as we continue to move the city of Springfield forward. I have not done this alone. Again, I have a great team, the Echo Dev team led by Kevin Kennedy, and each and every one of you, for your continued belief and investment here in the city of Springfield. We're very bullish on the city. As long as I continue to be around or the people will have me, we will continue to act and we will continue to be the capital of Western Massachusetts. It's a glorious time right now in the city of Springfield, and you're all part of that success, and I deeply appreciate that. So, another person who is extremely a big part of that success, again, I call him Coach Kennedy, and continues to fill out those brackets for March Madness as we continue to do this. Put your hands together for our Chief Development Officer, Kevin Kennedy.
Thank you very much, and welcome to the Basketball Hall of Fame. It's a new venue this year, and it's a great crowd every year. I'm always amazed at the attendance and the interest that everybody has. Mayor, thank you for that introduction. You've been mayor now for 12 years, looking for another 4 years. That will make you the longest serving mayor in the history of Springfield. And you will also be mayor for almost 5% of our history. So that's quite an accomplishment, and we hope you make it. Let me also thank the regional chamber. You've been a great partner. Back when we were trying to move the city forward some 7 or 8 years ago, We had to reach out and establish partnerships, and the Chamber has been a great partner. Nancy and Jeff Jafrida before you. I can't say enough good things about that. You've been a great partner. Let me also briefly thank the Hall of Fame for making this venue available to us. They have a very, very important part in our mosaic here in Springfield. I should also mention, as we go forward, the mayor mentioned the bracketology. In the next 3 weeks, as that tournament winds down and they end up in Minneapolis, the Hall of Fame will be announcing their new incoming class. That'll be here in, I think, late August, early September. MGM is also bringing four nights of Aerosmith. We'll have our jazz festival downtown, our Mattoon Street Festival. It'll be a very, very busy place, and it's so great to be able to talk about different things and entertainment options that we have in Springfield. We've come a long, long way. Let me also thank the staff. This doesn't happen by accident. Our planning director, Phil Dromey, our economic assistant, Brian Connors, Scott Hansen, and Jason Mann. They do a great job on this. While I get up here and be able to do this, they do all the work. So let me briefly say, today you're going to hear about the continuation of a remarkable renaissance for Springfield and, frankly, the whole region. We should all be very proud of our accomplishments. We should also look forward to the publication of a previously unpublished work written by one of the great sons of Springfield, Ted Geisel Jr., a.k.a. Dr. Seuss, and that should be out sometime this summer or fall. And without further delay, let us move into our video that was produced by Focus Springfield, and we'll move right into the presentation. Thank you. Thank you, Focus Springfield. We'll now move into some of our planned and proposed new projects. CRC Phase 2 is a $4 million project. It's the construction of a new 42,000 square foot warehouse. CRC currently has 248 employees in Massachusetts, and CRC is also building cars for Philadelphia and Los Angeles. Springfield is the proud home of CRRC's North American headquarters. We have to start thinking and moving forward about the Convention Center garage. It's a project cost of at least $40 million. Our Civic Center garage is nearing the end of its useful life. The Springfield Parking Authority continues to make repairs. The logical place to look at the new expansion would be behind TD Bank. It is currently owned by the Springfield Redevelopment Authority, and we need to have a creative partnership that will bring more amenities beyond parking. And as we look at that picture up there on the screen right now, that is a rendering done for us by the UMass Design Center. That's what the garage potentially could look like. We have good news finally for the former York Street Jail. A lot will be happening on the riverfront, including the York Street Jail site. We have a proposed Springfield Water and Sewer project of $100 million. It'll be the construction of a new 62 million gallon per day pump station. The start date will be this spring. In addition to the York Street area where we talked about the pumping station, we will also have a $37 million project on the same site. The SRA and the Pioneer Valley Hotel Group are currently negotiating a redevelopment project. Finally, the York Street jail site gets quality development. We will have more news on this project as we move forward. Wayfinders is an almost $17 million project. It's a new 23,000 square foot office building. It's on the former location of the Peter Pan bus terminal. It has great urban design directly across from Union Station, and it should be open by the spring of 2020. Here's another project that is previously unannounced. On the corner of Main and Union Street will be a new CVS at a project cost of almost $2 million. It'll be starting this spring and should be finished by the end of this year. And as you look at the CVS that we're proposing, our planning department has done a great job working with Davenport. It'll have it's an example of a good urban design with the building at the street edge with lots of glass. The Marriott brand is coming back to Tower Square, a project cost of at least $27 million. It's a full upgrade and renovation of the hotel, and it will be rebranded as a Marriott Hotel. It'll also be home to the new, it's also home to the White Lion Brewery. A great reuse and restoration of State Street's most majestic building, the Masonic Temple. A $14 million project by the Springfield Performing Arts Academy. It'll be a complete renovation of the six-story, 85,000 square foot building. It's opening this August. It's hard to see from this exterior, but there is a beautiful 1,300 seat theater on the top floor of this building. Fresh, local, high quality food will be the new staple for city schools. The Springfield Culinary and Nutrition Center on Caldwell Drive opened in February of this year. It's a 58,000 square foot facility. It incorporates local purchasing and farm to school and student education. Another new project for Springfield, the redevelopment of the former Registry of Motor Vehicle site at 165 Liberty Street. It'll be a new Cumberland Farms that will be offering prepared and fresh foods. It'll be in a neighborhood that currently underserved for gas and convenience. Let me now introduce the president of MGM Springfield, Michael Mathis.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Kevin. I'm going to jump right into it. If you would play the video.
Feel it, baby.
Thousands of people from all over New England are flocking to the region's newest entertainment destination.
MGM Springfield officially opened for business Friday morning.
I'm too excited. As soon as I got in the elevator, I was like, we did it!
I've been doing news here in Springfield for 40 years now, and I've never seen a day like this.
But now to be able to be partners with MGM is going to bring so much excitement to this area.
For hours and hours, people were outside of MGM Springfield waiting for their chance to finally see what this place is all about.
In my opinion, this is probably the biggest event in the history of Western Massachusetts.
I want to show you just some of the attention to detail.
Atmosphere is fantastic. You know, you got everybody psyched and we're jumping and we're ready to go.
A turning point for a city that set their sights on a vision and never looked back.
Springfield, you took a chance. I promise it'll be worth it.
Thank you, everybody. Pretty amazing to reflect on that day and what you all did to help us get that facility open. Just at the outset, I'd like to recognize some folks, because when I get into the presentation, I always end up forgetting the people that really helped us get along. And there are many of you, but I'm just going to call out a few. I'm looking at the front row, Chuck Irving with the Davenport Group. You saw his CVS building. He's been our development partner in the South End neighborhood. He was really here before I was here, because he was the guy buying up property before they knew it was casino money. So Chuck and the Davenport team, just want to thank you for all the work you've done. I saw Leo Florian come through from the South End Neighborhood Council. I just had coffee with Leo 2 days ago. Leo's always great about sharing his opinions on how we're doing. Those of you who knew Leo know what I'm talking about. But Leo, you've been fantastic and really supported us as our host neighborhood council back when we were just a concept and a couple of sketches on a piece of paper. So Leo Florin, thank you and the entire neighborhood council. Paul Pignelli, goes without saying, we wouldn't be here if it weren't for Paul. Blue Tarp redevelopment is literally your vision from the Monarch Tower when you watch the tornado come through. I could spend all the afternoon talking about what you've done for us in this community, but I'll just say thank you, Paul. And then one last one is, if my executive team from MGM Springfield, if you folks could stand up, you're peppered throughout the audience. Yeah. Thank you. Amazing group of people. They didn't sleep 6 months before this was open, and I think they haven't slept since. So it's been a roller coaster, and I thank you for all your support. So with that, I'm going to share a few insights about what we've seen in the last 6 months and share a little bit about the project. You can advance the slide. So just a couple of highlights from media, and what I'm really proud of is we've shown a spotlight on Springfield and gotten the attention of some big media. So Condé Nast Traveler, their magazine, featured us in their December issue of the magazine. The Boston Globe, Mark Arsenault, who's been a great friend to Springfield and the project, came out for a secret shop in January. And then, of course, our local 22 News covered us as well. And I just highlighted a couple of comments. You know, Condé Nast Traveler said, MGM Springfield is only 2 weeks in, but feels like it's always been there. And I think it's a real testament to the neighborhood and the attention to detail we put in to make sure it felt like a part of the community. The Boston Globe, Mark said it was a lively Friday night when he came and visited, but I think one of the things I was most proud of is he called out that there may not be a more racially diverse large entertainment venue in Massachusetts. And he was talking about our employees and our customers. And that's something that we as a company are incredibly proud of, because it really highlights the diversity of this beautiful city. And then 22 News in the early days just called out how many folks were coming from outside of the jurisdiction. So we're attracting people from Nevada, New York, Connecticut, Rhode Island, Pennsylvania, Virginia. So tremendous exposure. One of the other things that we have fun with is we send surveys out. We're always looking for data from our customers, and they're always happy to share it. So here's a little sample of some of the feedback we get. I didn't win today. I'm going back to Mohegan. I suspect they came back when they didn't win at Mohegan. This one drives our celebrity chef crazy. Calamari does not have spaghetti and meatballs. Fortunately for Red Rose, they do. So that customer is finding it somewhere. Someone complained that the DJ only played hits from the 2000s. And this is my favorite. No indoor smoking, which stinks. I don't know if that guest realized how clever and ironic he was being, but I enjoy that one. This is in the category of pretty good. Love the smoke-free environment. And frankly, that's a comment that we get a lot, and I think is something that's a real asset. Staff is friendly and helpful. Excellent experience, beautiful rooms and showers. And then this morning, I watched staff clean areas of the restaurant that I would never have imagined could be cleaned. So I shared that with our cleaning crew, which I thought was a great compliment. And then this last one is really reflective of many comments we get. And I won't read the whole thing, but it really talks about their first time at MGM Springfield and how they found the campus so perfectly integrated into the city of Springfield with beautiful open space, large casino, great restaurants, Chandler's and Calamari, and lots of fun venues for guests of all ages from all walks of life. And we get a ton of those type of comments, which is really a testament to the work that we've all done. Want to share a little bit about the visitor profile. We are now a little bit less, this was as of the end of February, so call it 6 months. 2.7 million total visitors have come to our facility. All 50 states represented, many international as well. If you look at the pie chart on the left, almost exactly half of our customers, unique visitors, have come from outside the state. So we're bringing new customers and consumers outside of this jurisdiction who are spending dollars and supporting this local economy, which is exactly what we said we would do. And if you look to the right, nearly half of those visits are also from outside the jurisdiction. So that's a big part of the economic development mission, and of course something that Kevin was focused on when we pitched what we wanted to do to him and the mayor. And then you see a little bit of an age profile, just a breakdown of as you can see, it speaks to all different walks of life and all different demographics. A little bit on employment, because that's certainly something that we've really focused on. You'll see our various goals represented, and I'll just quickly go through them. We set a target of 35% Springfield residents would be in our employee ranks. Due to the hard work of Mary Kate Murren and our HR team, we're at 39.3%. Nearly 40% of the men and women you meet on our casino floor are your friends and neighbors from Springfield. Incredibly proud of that, and they're some of the best workers we have in our entire company. Women, we set a target of 50%. We're nearly there. We have gender sort of biased positions like security and facilities that we try to overcome with our recruitment. Minorities, at 50% target, we're at 54.9%. So again, a very diverse facility. And most proud of is we're nearly triple our target for veterans, 5.8% compared to 2%. Thank you. And then briefly, a little bit about our marketing. So much of it is about our partnerships. You'll see represented some of our partners, and they represent some of the best brands in the Commonwealth and in Western Mass. Paul Picknelli's Thunderbirds, of course, but the big New England sports partners we all have, they're part of our roster of relationships. John DeLeva and Paul, of course, as the Basketball Hall of Fame is an important partnership. And we just announced a marquee relationship with the Red Sox. We are going to go on the center wall of the Green Monster, taking the other guys off the wall, and we're going to be bringing Winter Weekend out here in January. So incredibly excited to host them in Springfield. And then you'll see just a sample of how we activate. This is activation at Gillette, where we took over the parking lot and the tailgate and really exposed all of those customers to Springfield and our project. And then a little sample of what we do in terms of cross-marketing. If you go into our database as a customer, you'll be exposed to these different relationships and deals. 10% off merchandise with the Thunderbirds, Worcester Railers as well. You get a discount, Basketball Hall of Fame, a discount on admissions, and then New England Patriots, you get a discount. So there's many, many more, but that's just a sample of how we try to spread the wealth a little bit. On to entertainment. On the entertainment side, this is just 2018. Of course, we opened with Stevie Wonder, and we had Bill Burr, a comedian, some more comedians in MassMutual Center as well. As Kevin mentioned, we're following that up at the end of April with Cher and four shows in Aerosmith in MassMutual Center as well. And then some community events, and this is really when I think the property shines. We do a jam fest with the bid. We've got Christmas holiday activation. And one of the special events is the Ride to Remember, which respects some fallen heroes that were first responders. And this is just some photos of all the great activation. you know, that anybody that was there for the tree lighting really saw the community come together, and it was a really special night. Top of the corner is our concert series with Dropkick Murphys, and bottom right is the Right to Remember. A fun day when I met Nancy Kerrigan as well to open up our ice rink. And this is the upcoming entertainment. We have a Roar Comedy Club. For those of you who haven't seen it, know it as the old South End Community Center Mayor. It looks glorious, and it's a makeshift live comedy venue now, three times a weekend. We've got Cher at the end of April, as I mentioned, Aerosmith in August. Some said that we couldn't sell four shows of Aerosmith, where we're selling that show out, and it's going to be an amazing August when 20,000 people descend on downtown. And then our Outdoor Plaza, 15 shows, 10 of which will be free concerts and 15 paid. So great activation of the Outdoor Plaza. And then I'm going to close on economic impact, because that's what this discussion really is about. We told Kevin, we told the mayor that you would see a lift in the surrounding businesses. There's an article quoted where different businesses have quoted about a 20% lift anecdotally from when we opened. They're extending hours, they're seeing increased business. And then we did a little business case of a hotel downtown. You can see what they did in 2017 in terms of occupancy and daily rate, and then the same period after we opened. Up 20% in occupancy and daily rate. And the last slide really takes that point home. This is a comparison of the room occupancy tax that the city collects, as well as the meal tax. And if you look at the period of time, again, 2017 before we opened, and then 2018 after we opened, room occupancy tax is up 68%, and meal tax is up 22%. So it's not just the resort and the impact we're having, but the lift is given to the rest of the business community. So hopefully you're all feeling it. If you're not, we should talk, because we want to make sure that all ships rise with a rising tide. So thank you all, and thank you for being here.
Thank you, Mike. I think we would all agree that there's a new vibe, and then something new is going on. You've brought a great deal to Springfield, but frankly, we want more. Let's now move into some of our project updates. Our new downtown police force is making a difference. Thanks to the bid, we have a new fully staffed visitor center located directly across from the Mass Mutual Center, a dedicated unit assigned to the downtown staff with 41 officers and supervisors. Union Station has certainly taken its rightful place in Springfield and the region. Our ridership is up to people are passing through there at the rate of 3 million people a year, and we're looking forward to new expanded rail service this July. We'll be activating the platforms that are already built in Holyoke, Northampton, and Greenfield. Two round trips daily. We expect 24,000 passengers a year. In addition to that, Governor Baker has given us $1 million east-west commuter rail study that is currently in progress. We'll be building a new school, Brightwood Lincoln Elementary School. It's a project cost of a little bit over $70 million. We will be replacing the Brightwood and Lincoln Elementary School, located adjacent to Chestnut Middle School. We expect an opening in 2021. Big Y continues to invest in Springfield. A new Big Y distribution center at a project cost of $46 million. It's a planned 232,000 square foot expansion, 32 new full-time employees, and the completion date is this year. Another anchor institution, Mass Mutual, continues to grow its investment in Springfield. They're relocating 1,500 employees to Springfield. The workforce will now be over 4,500 employees. They'll spend $300 million in Massachusetts, $50 million of which will be here in Springfield, and the project should be completed by 2021. Educare Springfield is a $14 million project. It's a 27,000 square foot state-of-the-art building located in the Old Hill neighborhood. Educare Springfield will be one of 25 Educare facilities across the country and the only one in Massachusetts. It'll serve 141 children, and it should be completed and open by September of this year. This long vacant historic building will come back to life as market rate residential, finally. project cost of almost $14 million, 60 market rate studio, 1 and 2 bedroom units. It will be started next month. The region's largest employer, Bay State Health, continues to invest in their facilities and healthcare services. Recent investments of nearly $100 million include the now operational $27 million cogeneration plant pictured in the above right-hand corner of the screen. After many delays, the Innovation Center is now open. A $7 million project developed Springfield completed this redevelopment. It had a grand opening in February of this year. It's a partnership with Mass Development, and Mass Mutual is also a major contributor. And a big thing is a new restaurant will be located on the ground floor very soon. One of the two last projects in downtown that have a paramount importance, excuse the pun, the Paramount Theater redevelopment is a $41 million project. We're currently closing on a $3.65 million loan. The project will include preservation and reuse of the historic theater, and also the hotel in the back of the building will also be renovated. With both city and state support, this project continues to move forward. Elm Street redevelopment. We're hoping to make an announcement on this $56 million project in the next week or two. It's critical to downtown. It's been cited in every study that's been done on the downtown. There'll be 74 residential units and 35,000 square feet of commercial space, and it's a partnership between Opal Development and Wind Residential. Indian Motorcycle, finally gonna get started. It's a $25 million project, 60 new affordable residential units. The tax credits were awarded in February. This project also includes the restoration of the historic Mason Square Fire Station. Chestnut Towers is a major project for downtown. It's an $87 million investment. It'll be the renovation of all 489 units. We'll have all new windows and a number of new amenities. This project, along with Indian Motorcycle and the soon-to-come Brookings School, will provide more than 600 new and refurbished affordable housing units in the city of Springfield. Valley Bike is a regional bike share program, and the partners include Springfield, Holyoke, Northampton, Amherst, UMass, and South Hadley. 185,000 miles have been logged in the system in 2018, and Springfield is the highest participant. The bike station will be back on the streets in a couple of weeks. You've all noticed the wayfinding signage in the downtown. We're fortunate to have a compact and very walkable downtown. Our new pedestrian wayfinding system helps visitors easily find their way. Thanks to the Springfield Cultural District, we will be hosting the city's first mural festival, Fresh Paint Springfield, this June. This festival will feature 10 nationally recognized artists creating murals throughout the downtown. One site is up on the screen. It'll be the back of the parking garage adjacent to the Chestnut Towers. The downtown dining district is real. It's a $1.5 million fund. The first restaurant, Naismith's Pub and Pretzel, recently opened in the space next to Theodore's. Our second restaurant, Barkaya, will feature sushi, and it's slated to open this April. Our community development block grant program is very important to the city as a whole. We offer business loans and storefront improvement programs. We're also investing $300,000 per year in the program. Citywide, we spend $6.9 million, and that picture up on upper right hand is a very recognizable mom in Rico's, who is one of our customers. Let me now introduce John DeLiva, the president and CEO of the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame.
Well, thank you, Kevin. Thank you for inviting me to speak in the Basketball Hall of Fame tonight. We're welcoming all of you here. Mr. Mayor, thank you also for your support and welcoming us here tonight. As the slide shows, we have just completed a $30 million capital campaign that was raised mostly from the basketball community. When I think back to when I first got here in 1999, the question was, where is the basketball community in supporting the Basketball Hall of Fame? Well, the answer is we had work to do from 1999, the year 2000, when we opened up in 2002, until a couple years ago, to really connect with the basketball community, and we did that. And we got a $30 million contribution primarily from the basketball community. We're very proud of that. We've engaged them. They've all been here. They're very excited about the fact that the game was invented here in Springfield, Massachusetts. This is kind of Mecca. But I do want to, the other 8%, we have some great donors that are probably in this audience. If not, they're in our greater community. And I want to recognize them. People often say in no particular order, but I'm going to say in a very particular order. We've got support from the Mass Mutual Foundation, and they will be presenting the 1891 Gallery, which will be a brand new space for us, opening up in 2020, which represents companies. The idea behind that is the companies in the local area that were around for so many years ago, 1891, that wanted to celebrate the fact that basketball was invented here in Springfield. We've invited them in to support the game, and Mass Mutual has taken that and run with it. The Belize Auto Group, can't say enough about Jeb and the group and the family. Very supportive of so many things in our area. He's very excited, which I was, kind of touches my heart a little bit. He was excited about how we turned this business around from 2002 when we opened up. Almost on the ropes, and I really appreciate the support of the Belize Auto Group and the Belize family, so thank you for that. The Davis Foundation, they're everywhere. I'd like to thank them. I mean, they have been here for us back in the old days, back in the new days, and they'd like to see the progress and the impact, economic impact the Hall of Fame has. Jim Vinnick, who is a trustee, and also has his own financial investment company in Springfield. Goes back two generations supporting the Hall of Fame. Frank Colacino, Colvest Group, appreciate his support. Also a board of governor here. XL Dreyer and the Gagnon family. Florence Bank and the Chicopee Savings Foundation and Westfield Bank. There are some other organizations that have supported us, but I just want to mention those folks that have really stepped up in the local community and helped support us. So let's go on. We're in the best financial history we've ever had, which is very pleasing to me, but it's been such a disaster in the past that I guess I haven't done that good of a job, right? But let's go on, thank you. So you saw the lobby tonight. Many people came up and said that I didn't know this was done. What's happening out there? This looked like a mall in the 1990s that had no definition. It could be a Sears on one side and a JCPenney on the other, up until about a year ago. We reclaimed that space, about 3,000 square feet out there. If you're not walking down the hallway and think you're walking into the Basketball Hall of Fame, then we failed. And that's what our whole objective out there tonight was. So we spent about $5 million on that. We've got a brand new theater that I think is the best business theater for 170 seats in Springfield or Western Mass or Western New England. We will be showing our new movie that we have. We've done a introductory movie as folks come in to the Hall of Fame. We're going to have that running after this engagement is over and during the cocktail hour. So I invite you to go in, experience the theater, experience the movie that we have that kind of welcomes you into the Basketball Hall of Fame. I'm very excited about this concept. I was actually down in Cambridge today meeting with our museum designers. I was going to say look up at these plaques that are up here, but they're all dark and kind of gone to sleep at this point. But we are out of room up here. We had a two-dimensional interface with Hall of Famers. It was a plaque, and it was about 2.5 paragraphs of information, and that was about it. What we're going to build is a brand new space, 3,800 square feet, on our second floor in the back area, that is going to be totally digitally immersive and help you understand who these Hall of Famers were, whether they were the first Hall of Famers way back in the late 1800s, 1920s, 1930s, or the most recent Hall of Famers. Imagine 50 LED, 55-inch LEDs aligning one wall that brings Hall of Famers alive, whether, again, they go back to 1891 or they go back to 2018, 2019. As you can see in the bottom of this presentation, this is kind of a representation of what it's going to be all about. There will be regular shows of the most cherished Hall of Famers. You'll be able to dig in deep to Hall of Famers, back to every Hall of Famer that's here. We're going to bring them alive. It's going to be a great area that we have. We're very excited about that. That will open in June of 2019. And so if we take down all these plaques, because we've run out of room, and we don't want to make a two-dimensional presentation anymore about Hall of Famers, what are we going to do with it? We're going to use the verticality of this space, because when you stand down here, you should look up and really think you're looking into basketball heaven. We're going to continue that with 20, 21, 24, we haven't decided yet, with memorable moments in basketball. So when you're up there, you're experiencing it. When you're down here, you see it as a huge presence. That will be opened in February of 2020. Also, the rest of the museum in the second floor will be done throughout the year, late 2019, opening up in 2020. All interactive, a lot of digital experiences. It's just going to be an awesome spot. It's kind of a, you know, it's kind of a fun park of basketball experiences. That's what we want to create here. And when we opened this place in 2002, it was right at the cusp of the digital revolution, and we weren't quite ahead of that. And we truly will be the world's finest sports museum once again with this opening. And what about the outside dome? There's been some talk in the media 10 years ago and lately. That poor guy on the upper picture there, he realizes that that is one of 860 pieces like he's holding that have to be stripped off the top of the dome outside and refinished. And the underlayment of the outside dome has to be redone. I will say that if anybody tells you they want to build you a round roof, don't let them. And if anybody tells you they want to punch holes in that round roof to light it, don't let them do that either. You can see the on the right here and on the lower picture, those are the lights that were guaranteed for a lifetime, and I hope it wasn't my lifetime because those are coming off in a couple of weeks. You can see they've aged not so well, there's leaks. So what we're going to do is take all those panels off, we're going to refinish it. We are going to relight the museum, which I'll show you in just a couple of seconds. But the whole thing is going to be redone because we're making an investment inside of $19 million. We don't want any leaks to impact that. So can you go back up one? I'm sorry. So this is a lot of what you'll see this summer. I'm not a construction guy, but what I do know, if I was to name that, I would say that's a big-ass crane right there. You're going to see two of those out there. You're going to see a road cut in. You're going to see a lot of dishevelment of our front lawn, but it's all going to be great, and we are going to redo it. And if you go on to the next one, when we finish, the dome will all be redone, repainted. We will actually expand the lighting in the front. The lighting in the front, this building, when it was designed, is supposed to be a basketball going through a net, latitude, longitude lines, and you can see those now, and we're going to highlight those, the net, basically the flat part of our building. So it's going to be very striking. We'll be able to change the colors of that. There are not going to be 860 individual lights that absorb water and send it down to center court. There is going to be some great projection lighting up there. So we're looking very much forward to that. The payoff. I mean, this is, the timing works out, whether it was designed or not. This building, people told me tonight, they love what they see tonight. I said, well, go ahead and go upstairs and take stuff because we're going to change the whole thing. Go up and put stuff in your pocket. From top to bottom, 100% inside and outside, this museum, which is only 18, 19 years old, is going to be redone. And we are going to get a great class of 2020 to break the seal of that with Kobe Bryant, Kevin Garnett, Tim Duncan, and so many others. It's going to be the ride in the 2020s for the Basketball Hall of Fame in terms of enshrinements is going to be awesome. And lastly, We've worked on a side project, which is a commemorative coin, not by the people that do it in the back of the Parade magazine, but by the U.S. Mint. This is a coin that celebrates the invention of the game in Springfield, Massachusetts, and the fact that the game has gone around the world so quickly. And we have been approved by the U.S. Congress. The U.S. Mint is working on it. We're working with their marketing group. I think this is going to be the most productive commemorative coin that they have ever done at the U.S. Mint. And this is a real international opportunity, unlike most of the coins that they do. That is a representation of the Apollo coin, which I thought was terrific art and terrific representation. There's some representations over here of the coin that we designed to show Congress how we needed the coin might be designed. But there is a public art competition to create one side of this coin, which just launched today at noontime. So we're very excited about that. And I will tell you that the Baseball Hall of Fame did this in 2013, 2014. And because there's an upcharge to the coin collectors, the Baseball Hall of Fame netted $8 million to support their mission and their organization. So I told the Mint director that we will be their number one. So everybody in this room has to take a coin. You got to buy a coin tonight? No, I'm just kidding. We're gonna really take this to the next level in terms of opportunity. So thank you so much. Welcome to the Hall of Fame. When you come back here in about 18 months, everything will be done top to bottom, inside and out. And it's so nice to have you all here. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Just to context everything that John just talked about, in 1978, I drove Henry Tarzan Cooper to his induction ceremony that was on the campus of Springfield College. I picked up Tarzan at the Marriott Hotel, brought him to the campus, walked into the Hall of Fame. Up on the balcony, there was a German band playing Umpapa, Umpapa. You had tables and chairs set up. They were of the folding variety, of course. And you had lunch. Lee Williams got up and made too long of a speech, but congratulated everybody and their entrance into the Hall of Fame, gave each one of them a plaque and said, thank you, now you can go back to your hotel. So we've come a long, long way since that day. So thank you, John. Now let's move into some of our neighborhood projects. A good example of a new and smaller scale project across the city. The East Forest Park Library is a $9.5 million project. It's located adjacent to the Mary Dryden Veterans School. It's currently under construction and should be completed by November of this year. As I started to say before, an example of some new projects across the city include two new Pride gas stations. One on Wilbraham Road and one on State Street. You may remember what was on State Street previously, the old River Inn, which was much criticized. These new projects will amount to about $4 million, and gas stations have taken on a completely different look in the 21st century. No longer are they just places to gas your car. You'll have healthy food options, and they'll be opening in March of this year and in the fall of this year. The Wellspring Greenhouse, I've spoken to you previously about this. It's a $900,000 project. It's a cooperative venture to grow produce and sold in our local schools and supermarkets, and has been a great success. One of the indications of the health of our city is $100 million worth of new building permit activities from July of last year to February of this year. $36 million on the residential side, $62 million of non-residential. We also have a number of parks that are happening throughout our city that are very, very important, especially in the downtown. Pynchon Park, this project reopens a critical pedestrian linkage between Chestnut and Dwight Street. It'll serve as the new front door of our museums complex. It's a $4 million project. Construction should start in May and finish next year. Stern Square and Duryea Way is an almost $2 million project. It's a full renovation of Stern Square and Duryea Way. It's currently scheduled for completion in the spring of this year. An exciting new one, partially funded by MGM, a Riverfront Park 9/11 Memorial. It's an almost $3 million project. It will be a complete renovation of the riverfront, and also will have a new 9/11 design integrated. We expect the grand openings to occur on June 12th and June 19th of this year. The Forest Park Culvert is a $3.5 million project. It's a complete replacement of the historic culvert running under Forest Park. Not a sexy project, but a very, very important project, and should be starting this spring. Ruth Elizabeth Park is a $450,000 project. It'll be ADA accessible and a universal access to the park. It'll be starting this year, and it's part of our Central Street realignment project. Greening the Gateway Cities, Springfield is one of 14 cities participating. The program aims to plant 2,400 shade trees over 3 years in the McKnight, Old Hill, and Upper Hill neighborhood. If you'd like a tree, call 311. Congratulations to Judy, Matt, and Bright Nights. It's their 25th anniversary. They've brought 5.4 million visitors since they've opened from 35 states, Mexico, and Australia, with 2.5 million hits on social media. Thank you, Spirit of Springfield. Let's move into some of our Department of Public Works projects. We've been talking about for a while the X redesign. It is slowly moving forward. It is project currently at 25% design. It's an $11.5 million project. We hope to start in the fall of 2021 and be completed by 2022. The Six Corners Roundabout is a $4.6 million project. It's a complete reconfiguration of the intersection. We will be starting next month, and we should be completed by May of next year. Central Street realignment is a long time coming, $5.4 million project. We expect to start the project this July and complete it by the spring of next year. This new road layout will better serve the adjoining neighborhoods and also Springfield College. The Marble Street extension is currently in process. It's a $3.7 million project. It will greatly improve the street network in the South End, and it should be completed by June of this year. The mayor mentioned earlier that our new total investment in Springfield since our last report is $400.4 million. And the exact total of the development investment in Springfield since the tornado of 2011, $4.16 billion. Now I'd like to take some time for us to think about what's next. What's next? We need a new Hampden County courthouse. As Senator Welch recently articulated in an op-ed piece, we need a new courthouse to replace our outdated and deteriorating courthouse that happens to be one of the busiest in the state. This needs to be a priority for all of us. The city is currently also exploring our capacity and potential locations for a new police headquarters to replace an outdated and bursting at the seam police headquarters. New hotel development. As the number of visitors coming to downtown Springfield continues to grow, the need for additional hotel rooms has become a priority. Numerous developers are looking at locations throughout the downtown and also the South End. We need to start thinking and doing something about Symphony Hall and City Stage. As reported, MGM has taken over the management of Symphony Hall. In partnership with the city, this facility will see upgrades in the near future. As various types of entertainment continue to grow in Springfield, we also need to look at reopening City Stage. We would welcome ideas from the business community as to what the new vision for this facility should be. And last but not least, the police expansion in the South End. We expect an announcement soon on a substantial new automotive dealership coming to the South End. Thank you for being here today, and more importantly, thank you for your continued support investment, and confidence in building a stronger and more vibrant city of Springfield. We hope that after today's presentation, you can see new opportunity and ways to be part of the city's growing renaissance. Please now join us in the lobby for a reception and enjoy the video produced by Focus Springfield. Thank you all so much.